Do a lot of people compare you to other bald people and ask you whether you're related?
Sometimes. I guess I get the, dude, you look like Kerry King, or dude, you look like Tony from Static, or dude, you look like Aaron Lewis, or dude, you look like David Draymond, or dude, you look like Shaun Glass.
It's just like, because you're bald, you look like all these other people, yeah?
Dude, you look like the Mighty Z.
And remember, I'm not only the heckler president, but I'm also a client.
So I'm cool with it. I'm always cold. My band always makes fun of me because I always turn the air conditioner off in the bus because I'm freezing. And if anyone asks, that's why I always usually wear a beanie on stage. But it's because I'm always cold. So I don't know why. Ever since I shaved my head, I'm always freezing. But shit happens.
Did you ever have any sort of a comb over, or did you wear a hat for a long time, long period of your life?
No, I never really wore baseball hats. Just when it started going, I think even in the early 90s of Broken Hope, it started, I don't know if it was a comb over, but you know, I started having the Seasons in the Abyss Kerry King look, I think.
Right.
And it was like, yeah, it's time. And when I formed the band Soil, I was like, all right, it's time to shave my head, you know, so.
So you've been on three labels that I can think of. You've been on E1, you were on, right?
Yeah, Metal Blade. I've been on Rocket Science. I've been on, well, now I'm on Century Media, so it's cool. Yeah, I mean, and Soil was on, we were basically BMG.
Okay.
So not really, I'm a label whore, I guess, now, right?
I guess
right?
You are.
Sorry, labels. Thank you for believing in me as a songwriter.
There's really not that much difference from label to label. They're all pretty much the same.
I wouldn't say that. Yeah. I mean, I think labels right now are in a weird place, and they're learning to go with the times, but it's really about marketing and promotion and, you know, really believing in your band and understanding what the band's niche is and what their fan base is about. It's really not about how many records can you get on my shelf at the store, because let's be honest, there's not many stores to get on shelves anymore. There's a shelf inside the venue at our merch table that sells them. Otherwise, it's, you know, people hopefully buying digital or illegal downloading them and coming to your show and feeling guilty and buying the physical at the gig or buying a t-shirt. So please buy a t-shirt from every band you go see. It'd be really nice of you.
You buy something, right?
Yeah, man. Dude, you got to put gas in the tank and food on the table.
Will there be, does Metal Blade done any special reissues of any of the old stuff yet?
Oddly enough, they haven't yet. We thought for sure that the remastered bonus digipack Super 3D Space Saucer version would be coming out.
Sure.
But they haven't cashed in on our fan base yet for that. But hopefully they will. And hopefully they have a say in getting involved with us and let us, you know, let us have a say, I mean, and be involved, and that'd be cool. But I think some of those albums definitely need to be remastered badly, because like Repulsive Conception and Bowels of Repugnance are, you know, they're really quiet compared to today's standards. Sure. And it'd be cool, and you know, fix some things and touch up things, but you know, for the most part they haven't done that, and it's weird. We thought they for sure would, but it's cool. We're happy to be on Century Media though.
Is there any thought of ever re-recording any of the old stuff?
Well, one of the bonus tracks on Omen of Disease is Incinerated, which was technically the first song on Swamped in Gore. So we redid that, and we've been joking that, you know, up the road on the next album, maybe re-record another song off the second album, Bowels of Repugnance, to kind of keep it in order as a bonus track. So it's something that we've joked around, and me and Damien thought it'd be kind of cool. And you know, obviously we play, you know, 50% old material in the set, and this, you know, version of the band is really strong, and you know, I think Joe would be proud, you know. But I think that with technology and musicianship being a little better in certain areas, it'd be cool for us to re-record some oldies. But yeah, we redid Incinerated, and it is on Omen of Disease.
Cool. I think Suffocation have been doing that.
Damien was telling
every
me
song from the first album.
I like the new Suffo album. I think it rules.
It's very good.
Yeah, Terrence is a riffer. He's a ripper, man. Yeah, good riffer.
Ripping riffer.
He's a ripping riffer.
So are you. You write a plethora of riffs in Broken Hope. Is that correct?
Oh yeah, yeah. When I joined the band, you know, I was really excited to become a songwriter, and all the bands I've really been involved with, I definitely like to put my stamp on it. And you know, I definitely have creative juices flowing, and I'm just happy like to still be able to write music. And I haven't ran out completely. And you know, I think that the new Broken Hope album, Moment of Disease, I feel like those are some of my best death metal songs I have written. And I love, you know, the track Womb of Horrors, which opens the album. It's one of my favorite songs. And I think those, you know, actually Jeremy and I contributed on that song, you know, as partners, as team. And it's one of my favorite songs on the album, and as a songwriter for extreme death metal, that's one of my favorite songs. Like, if I was sitting in a room with someone's like, hey man, I want to hear some good death metal, I would play that track for them. I'm pretty happy with that song. As others, but I like that one a lot.
Tattoos and stretch stuff. Do you have anything of that going on your body?
Stretch stuff.
Oh my god. Like, clearly your ears are not stretched.
No, I'm not a scene core.
Okay.
Not my thing. I have some tattoos. I have my family name on my arm, I guess. This glass, and when I'm drunk, you just cover it, says ass.
Very cool.
But I have some tattoos, but you know, I really haven't got any new additions to the family in a while. But you know, I guess, you know, when I was younger, it was cool. But right. You know, the older you get, you're probably like, eh, I'm just lazy now. I don't really care.
Right.
But you know,
what's the point?
And I really don't have the same bank account as Kerry King to cover my head.
Right.
So you know.
Or Rob Halford, right?
Yeah. Well, he's the metal god, so you know. I hope their new album's good.
They're putting out a new one? Is that right?
I hope so. They just finished it.
It'll be the first one without K.K. Downing, right?
I know. It's kind of bizarre.
Right. It's a missing element of what we...
My bedroom was Judas Priest all over when I was a child. And I remember one of my posters above my bed was like a British Steel poster. And it had like K.K. Glenn, K.K. Glenn, and Rob. But it didn't have the bassist or the drummer.
They were always lurking in the shadows.
Yeah, those poor guys. But, you know... Ian Hill actually is probably one of the longest remaining original members of that band. And he's the bass player that not many people pay enough attention to. I call him the boulder because he doesn't move on stage.
You know, he does. He rocks back
he's
and
bolding.
Forth.
He's bolding. He's the boulder.
He's like rocking back and forth like a seesaw or something.
Yeah. He's rad. He's Ian Hill. I met him a few times. It was cool. Yeah. Scott Ian introduced me to him at... I went to see Anthrax... on the first version of the reunion tour with Joey and Dan Spitz, and it was in, I think, Santa Barbara.
Okay.
Or Santa Monica, maybe. And I was in LA recording, and I went and hung out with the Anthrax guys, and Scott introduced me to the Priest guys, and I'm like, I just want to meet Ian Hill. Like, just go up and go, dude, you're Ian Hill. And he's like, he was like in this like nice shirt, like after the show, like he was going bowling or something, like talking to chicks and stuff. It was hilarious. But I was like, wow, Ian Hill. But like nobody gave.
He was talking to girls.
Yeah, he was definitely trying.
Oh,
I think.
Cool. Yeah.
But it was pretty funny. Like, I'm Ian Hill.
Yeah.
But like, you know, that guy probably doesn't walk in many places. People recognize him, you know. But KK probably gets recognized.
And you do too, as other people.
Sometimes at the Starbucks in my neighborhood, they know me. They're like, "Oh, how's your band?" I'm like, "Yeah, cool. Can I get a grande latte with?"
Are you a latte guy? Cappuccinos,
no.
Fraps, and all that?
My drink is kind of bizarro. It's a venti soy ice cream tea latte.
Whoa.
Remember that. If you want to be my friend and you come to a gig with Starbucks and you bring me a venti soy ice cream tea latte, chances are you are definitely getting on the list. Or a free t-shirt.
Are you at all lactose intolerant?
Yes.
Okay.
That's my wife.
So you don't mess with milk at all then, huh?
No, man.
Cow milk, that is.
No, and ice cream will destroy me. It's bad.
But almond milk, almond and soy milk.
Almond milk's great, yeah. I love it. Totally love it. Really good. Almond milk is crushing.
Silk.
Yeah, silk's great.
Did you get a lot of flack from fans over your... deicide episode?
Yeah, you know, not flack. I had some interesting conversations with fans. We were just in Europe with Immolation, one of the best bands I've ever toured with in my life. Those guys are so cool. Anyway, I love those guys. Immolation rule. And they're big chocolate fans too, so we related. Anyway, but that's a whole other story.
Sure.
But anyway, yeah, there was a lot of drama about the whole deicide thing, and actually everyone's kosher now. Glenn and I text each other. He FaceTimes me before this tour, so everything's cool. You know, it was a bunch of little things that it just kept picking and picking, and finally just you know, the scab finally got opened, and it sucked how it happened, you know. And that night in El Paso, there was just so much bizarre stuff. Even before the show opened, there was weird stuff going on with the club, and then PA, and then Glenn's amp, and then the kid got his throat slit. So it was a really bizarre night, man. I don't know what happened that night, but it was weird. And then, you know, obviously fans jumped on it, and certain gossip music sites like to turn it around and create negativity out of it so that, you know, they could get some people to read their stupid websites.
Right.
But it hey man, you know, stuff happens on the road, you know. And this is death metal. Let's be real, you know. I mean, we're playing the most extreme form of music with people that have very extreme personalities.
Look at here, son, I'm no loudmouth snook. This is a dog, not a chicken.
So it happens, man. But everything's cool now. And dude, I think the new Deicide album is their best in years. I mean, it really is a, you know, it's a great CD, and I think Deicide really delivered a good album. So,
label mates.
Yeah, we're label mates, and it's a shame that how it ended. But there's even talk, we've joked around about going back out. But
yeah.
I think next time, Glenn will have his amp, and Shaun will have his amp. So if it does happen, it'll all be cool.
Lesson learned.
Yeah, we learned a lesson on that tour. Let's not share gear with other bands.
And so you're doing the tour with Oceano, it's Rivers of
Nile.
Nile.
Fallujah.
And Kublai Khan.
And Kublai Khan, a new band.
Yeah.
From Texas, I think. Yeah. Wow. They're cool. Kind of tough guy, hardcore, beat down type stuff.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah, right, they'll kick our asses.
Yeah, yeah.
I think they're 19.
No. Do they have a lot of stretched ears? There's a lot of stretched ears on this tour, I'd imagine, right?
A lot of holy people. No, I haven't. I don't think those kids are that.
It's the old thing by now, right?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I saw that stuff on Ozfest when I was back in the day and thought it was cheesy then. But, geez, they're own, man, you know. I know bands. I've actually seen bands that I've toured with that did have their earlobes stretched like they had elephantitis and stuff, but that have now fixed them normal. So I guess they realize that it's not cool.
Or at least not cool anymore.
Nah, dude, I'm happy. I never did anything. I had a septum piercing once like Rob, but... I took it out because everybody kept saying, oh, do you like Rob Flynn? I was like, yes, I do, but I don't want to be Rob, but that's not my thing. But I took it out after a while. And plus, it was so annoying, like when you get sick, like scraping boogers off of it and it'd be covered in crusty crap. Sometimes that thing looked disgusting.
Sounds like a good inspiration for your next album, lyrically, right?
Yeah, I'll tell Jeremy. He'll write a song about it. He could find a niche. If you give him a topic, Jeremy could twist it around into something completely disgusting. But Jeremy has certain phobias, if everybody would like to know. He hates if you fart or anybody shows him poop. Sometimes I'll text him gross poop pictures on the road, right. And he freaks out. He's like a fecal phobia. So for all you people out there that think Jeremy Wagner writes the gross lyrics, inside, he has some serious phobias of gross things.
Oh.
Which is ironic, right?
Did you want to talk about what we got over here on the left here?
You can show one if you'd like. That's up to you, Mighty Z.
Yeah. You want to hold that up right there?
Sure.
We can zoom into the... let me see if I can use the zoom.
Here. Yeah.
Cool.
This is some really good, fine California... medical use only, safe, made in Hollister, California, California's finest herbal organics. So for people that like to partake in this, this stuff is great. It's a friend of mine's company, and I truly support it.
Is there a website that you're familiar with? That
California's finest 420.com is where to go.
Do you have anything more you'd like to share with the viewers of Capital Chaos TV?
I'm just writing and recording and staying busy and writing good music and hopefully putting out some more killer albums and hopefully playing your town soon and being stupid and happy and enjoying the metal world, and you know, that's it. I'm just glad to still be able to do what I do and appreciate that I'm here, you know, playing in front of so many amazing people and getting to meet so many cool people every night. It's awesome. I can't even believe that I'm still doing it. So.
Hey, this is Chuck Billy from Testament, and I'm blowing it up.
I'm blowing it up.
Blowing up.
On Capital Chaos.
Capital Chaos.
In Capital Chaos.
Capital Chaos.
Capital Chaos.
Capital Chaos.
Capital Chaos.
Capital Chaos.
Capital Chaos TV.
Motherfucker. Go fuck your mother.